likewise the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and said unto them, Peace be unto you. And when he had so said, he showed them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. Then said Jesus unto them again, Peace be unto you. As my Father hath sent me, even so send I you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said unto them, Receive ye the Holy Spirit. Whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto them. And whosoever sins ye retain, they are retained. But Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said unto him, We have seen the Lord. But he said unto them, Except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. And after 8 days again, his disciples were within, and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst and said, Peace be unto you. Then saith he to Thomas, Reach hither thy finger, and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless, but believing. And Thomas answered and said unto him, My Lord and my God. Jesus said unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen, and yet believed. And many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written, that ye might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you might have life through his name.
Glory to thee, O Lord, glory to thee.
Please be seated. Well, we've survived brightly. I say that tongue-in-cheek, perhaps a little bit, but the truth of the matter is that after the bright and glorious Pascha, there's usually a counterattack and resurgence of the flesh, which steals away some of the good seed that was sown during the Holy Week. But we're still standing, and may God bless us as we move forward from this point back into the liturgical cycle of the Church, which picks up today with Thomas Sunday. Good question to ask ourselves, what happened between that day, soon that night of the resurrection, when the apostles were gathered together for fear of the Jews behind closed doors, and a few weeks later, when they're boldly proclaiming the gospel throughout Jerusalem? What happened? What changed in these men that were turning Jerusalem upside down? We're reading from the Acts of the Apostles. One simple thing, and only one thing. They saw the risen Christ, and they came to a full appreciation and belief that he had risen from the dead as God. As we look at Thomas, we have to see ourselves. And so we shouldn't be too hard on him in his faithlessness, as the Lord says. The Jews were something to be feared. They just crucified the Lord. And they had power to do the same to everyone that followed him. And so it was that the very night of the resurrection, after hearing from the women that the tomb was empty, and having heard from the angel that he'd gone from the tomb alive, and having run to the tomb, some of them, and seen an empty tomb, they were still gathered that night in fear of the Jews. This is an aside, just dawned on me. That's kind of like us after Pascha. We see the risen Lord, and we see the glory of his nature and who he is. We see these great church services. And then within a week, kind of like, we're back to fighting, fussing, fuming, anger, sin. What happened? Well, they were afraid. And they were assembled, it says, in fear of the Jews. The doors were shut. To give us a picture of how secluded they were.
The walls were solid, just like these walls. The doors were shut, just like these doors. And then all of a sudden, Jesus stood in the midst of them and said, "Peace be unto you." He came through the door unopened, or through the wall, I'm not sure which one. But he came in there in a resurrected body and stood in the midst of them and said the most important thing, "Peace be unto you." Though the world's fighting and fuming, they just crucified me. And though the Jews probably seek you in this very moment, and though you're in fear, he says, "Have peace." And then he showed him his hands and his side. His resurrected body bore those scars. And at lunch, we'll read a little bit from the fathers on the nature of the resurrected body, which we will share in someday. But this body, though it was a special body that could go through material walls, at the same time, it could be touched, and it could be felt, and it could be seen, bearing the scars of this life that were done for us. And the Lord then said, "Peace be unto you again." You see, the apostles had heard about an empty tomb, but they'd even seen the empty tomb, but they were still perplexed and wondering and afraid until Christ comes to them and shows himself risen. So it is with us. We need to have a glimpse in our hearts. We have to see, and more blessed are we if we can see it with our heart, the resurrection of Christ. Truly, this is what we need to turn the world upside down, at least in our own lives, if not in the lives of those around us. We need to have a belief and a faith that Jesus Christ rose. We need to be able to see him. We need to be able to touch him spiritually and to believe that he is, that he rose from the dead. Then the Lord breathes on them and he gives them the Holy Spirit, not in full, because that awaited Pentecost. And so what was this that he gave them? Simply, as it says in the sentence after, he says that I'm breathing on you, he's to receive the Holy Spirit. And then he says, "Whosoever sins you remit are remitted unto them, whosoever sins you retain are retained." At that moment, the Lord breathed on a special group of people, his disciples, his apostles, and he gave them power to go forth and loose and bind sins. This is an important power. And as I was reading the fathers about this, it struck me how one of the fathers particularly put his finger on the problem of the modern age. If anyone will claim to go forth and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, what they're preaching is the ability that God has to forgive our sins and to loose our sins. And at the same time, to preach the fact that if we don't go God's way, our sins are not loosed. And so these two things go together. The preaching of the gospel is required by the church, by the successors of the apostles, to loose people from their sins. And at the same time, for those that reject this gospel, to leave them in their sins. Churches today don't want to have anything to do with telling you they loose, your sins are loose. There's no confession. There's no authority of the church to say that God accepts your repentance. So therefore, how can there be the other side, which is the blinding, to tell people who isn't going to go to heaven? The authority of the gospel is indissoluble. It requires both sides. There's a heaven, there's a hell, there's eternal life, there's eternal death. And so it is that the Lord comes in his resurrected power to a specific set of men, and he gives them the power to bind and to loose sins through his blood shed on the cross and through his resurrection on the third day. It's in the risen Christ that sins can be forgiven. If there was no resurrection, we'd be of all, as Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, of all men, most miserable. If there's no resurrection, then we should be in fear. We should be huddled behind closed doors. We should be scared of death. But if there's a resurrection, then there's a binding and there's a loosing, particularly a loosing for those that believe. And so the Lord sends them out, finding this in his people and giving them this assurance that sins are forgiven because I arose. It's not untrue. I arose from the dead. You've seen me. You've seen the scars. You saw me go into the tomb. And now I'm here with you, walking through doors with a new body. And so shall it be with you. Well, there was one that wasn't there that day to behold this. His name is Thomas. He was one of the 12. He had this exalted position of apostleship. And for some reason, he wasn't there. The scripture records particularly for us his name, Didymus, which means twin. Well, the fathers are pretty clear that twin means he was of two minds. He had two minds about Jesus. And in this particular case, one of his minds was for sure that he died. But he wasn't so sure he rose again. And so he says, very confidently and boldly before his brothers, that unless I see him and put my hand on the print of the nails in his hands and feel that side wherewith came out blood and water, I will in no wise believe. A strong statement, but it's one that reflects the reality of his heart. God wants us to face ourselves where we are and to face him honestly. Are we like Thomas? Perhaps we are. There's no condemnation in that our faith is weak and that we're faithless. The condemnation is not to admit it before God.
Yes.
And so Thomas says, I won't believe until I see him. I am indeed faithless regarding his resurrection. He didn't believe. It wasn't enough for him that the apostles said this to him. They said clearly this little statement. We have seen the Lord. That's the statement that comes down through history to my ears, to your ears, to every person's ears, that men have seen the Lord risen. They've seen him with a glorified body. They've seen he who died on the cross and claimed to be God. They've seen him risen after death. This is a truth. This is what Thomas wasn't going to accept. And so, the Lord is gracious. You see, the Lord's gracious in this matter of belief in the resurrection, because belief in the resurrection is everything. If there is no resurrection of Jesus Christ as God, if he wasn't who he said he was when he went into that tomb and then arose, then there is no such thing as salvation. There's no way for us to get to heaven. The way is closed off. Death is the end.
Yes.
And so it is that we need to have assurance of this fact. We need to know that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. And so it is for even those of weak faith that God gives us a chance to believe. You see, 8 days later, Jesus came back again. And this time, Thomas was there. That was the Lord's design. And so in front of them all, he appears again. And particularly to Thomas. He hadn't had a lot of conversations with Thomas during that week. Had he? He hadn't known what Thomas had said. He was only a fleshly person. But the second he came in front of Thomas, he said, Thomas, I know what you said last week. And today, you're going to have an opportunity to come to faith. He says to him, reach hither. The first words out of his mouth to Thomas, reach hither thy finger. Behold my hands. Reach hither thy hand and thrust it into my side. Experience the reality of the resurrection for yourself. I want you to experience that. And he says, don't be faithless anymore. You were faithless. Don't be faithless anymore. But believing. Thomas, at that point, got it. He understood that Jesus Christ was who he said he was. He was the Son of God. He was God. He could go into the tomb and rise again for us. And he could have victory over death and open the gates of hell for every single person. He could forgive every single sin. He could remit every single sin. He could give that authority to his church, which he formed, to remit sins and to preach the gospel until he comes again. It was all real. And Thomas, at that point, gives this great confession The Father used a word for him. He became a theologian. He spoke the word, the Logos, about God. He said, my Lord and my God. What a wonderful confession. Very brief, but very direct and very true. Jesus said to him, Thomas, you're blessed now. You understand who I am, and you're going to do great things for me. But he says, a little bit of a dig, perhaps, but a true statement. More blessed are those that haven't seen and yet believe. The report of those who said, we've seen the Lord. That gospel record goes down through history. There's a knowledge that comes. There's a confession that comes. My Lord and my God, when we see the Lord, when we believe that others have seen him in his resurrected state. And then he goes at the end of this, he says, these things are written about me. You might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you might have life eternal through his name. Everything that's written about Jesus comes down to those 3 days, the death, the burial, and the resurrection. Did he die for us? Was he really dead in the tomb? And then did he really rise again? It was so important that Jesus came to Thomas, especially, to show him so that the apostolic group would be totally unanimous that we've seen the Lord on the other side of death. That gives us hope. That gives us power. That sets us off. We're fully absorbed now in the reality that Jesus has risen from the dead. And that if he rose from the dead, we can rise too. That nothing can kill us for eternity. Nothing can destroy his work in us, though we would be dead. And so it was that things turned around for the apostles. They left with this absorbed into their brains, into their hearts, this faith that Jesus Christ had risen from the dead. And they went out and they turned things upside down in the world, starting right where they were, and then spreading out throughout the entire world. The book of Acts records this in chapter 5 that we read today. When we have power, when we've seen the risen Christ, the church grows. When we've seen the Lord, the church grows. There's power. Believers are added to the church, it says. Multitudes, both of men and women. And then another thing that's pretty true about believers that really have seen the risen Lord, when Christ is in your heart by faith and you're believing in his name, you go forth and your mere presence changes things. It says here that people just wanted to go under the shadow of the Apostle Peter as he passed by. So great was the power of God working in these men that they just wanted to be in the shadow of him. That's the way it is with us. When we're changed by the power of Christ, wherever we go, there's a change just by our very presence. Whether we say anything or not, God's there and things happen. Then there's this great healing that goes on. It says that all kinds of people from the multitudes of the cities around about came bringing sick folk, it says, and those vexed with unclean spirits. And it says that they were healed, every single one. You see, when people are brought to Jesus, there's no shortage of healing power. The medicine doesn't run out. The hospital doesn't run dry. It can't be overflowed. There's unlimited grace and power to forgive the loose sins in the person of Jesus Christ. His sacrifice covered every single sin. His power can rise every single dead person to life everlasting. And so it was that even the prison doors were opened when men tried to imprison those and stop the preaching of the gospel. Nothing can stop the work of God, whether they came out of the jail or not. Jesus rose from the tomb. He was out of the tomb, and the gospel was unleashed to go across the entire world. That's what it's doing today. You know, as it says at the end of this little epistle, it says, go, the angel said, go, stand in the temple and speak to all the people the words of this life. That's what's happening today, 2,000 years later. We're preaching the central tenets of Christianity, this great truth, that Christ is risen from the dead. Christos Voskresen. Christ is risen. And so we can stand and proclaim in him the words of this life because he rose. God bless us all. Christ is risen.
He is risen.
Yes.